Okay.
Please be careful that you guys don't touch it. Maybe the problem is lightning. So these guys, annelids, arthropods, and chordates are segmented animals. So the arthropods is in next exam, and chordates is in the final exam. So those are on animal kingdom. Those are the three phyla that they are supposed to be segmented animals. And we human are chordated animals, right? We are chordate animals. We have a vertebral column. We call it chordate animals. So annelids and arthropods, they're also segmented. Metamerism, it means repeated segments. That's what's pretty much in biology, the term they use, the metamerism. What other animal you have seen that had repeated segments? But I didn't call them metamerism. Your textbook did not call it metamerism. What other animal you saw that you had repeated segments?
Tapeworms.
Okay? They had segments. The proglottids. Each proglottids was a repeated segment. But this is different because of repeated segments are eosinophilic animals and a few other things. What is the advantage, evolutionary-wise, what is the advantage of segmentation? If one segment break, disappear, something happens, the rest of the body can work. How many people do you know they lost one digit of their finger? Still their hand works. Is that right? Still the fingers work. How many people do you know they remove one of their spinal column, one of those vertebrae, you know what I'm talking about. They remove them and they still have a normal life. Okay? So that's the other. Classification of the annelids is based on segmentation, setae, and clitellum presence or absence. That's what these animals are being classified based. Annular is a circular groove which is outside of the animal, and I showed it to you before. If not, let's look at this model. Is that right? So I have this model right here, these grooves. You see the grooves? This is a metamere. This is a segment. But between each metamere, these are called annuli, the grooves. You know what I mean by groove. Okay, that. This portion right here is called the annular. Cephalization, some earthworm does not have much of cephalization. It means having a head, but that does not mean the rest of the animals in this phylum do not have head. Okay, so they do have head, is composed of two parts, prostomium and peristomium, followed by segmented body. What is prostomium? May or may not be retracted, and often bears eyes, tentacles, and sensory palps. Sensory palps, you will see this term more often later on, palp. It means it's used for sensing, for sensation. They sense the environment, see what is going on outside of them. That's what sensory palps are. Okay, I'll put all of these new PowerPoints in the DocuShare now. If you recently, over the weekend, you downloaded, you should have got this one. I'm sorry, I put it on weekends. But anyhow, peristomium surrounds mouth and maybe may have setae, palp, or chitinous jaws. That's what peristomium is. Stome, as you know, it means mouth. Peri, it means surrounding mouth. Peri on your prefix suffixes. Pro, it means before. Remember, protozoa, before. So before the mouth, and this is surrounding the mouth. Okay, I hope. And you will see it. Here are, I'm giving you an examples of segmented animals. The earthworms, annelids, the arthropods, and of course the chordate animals. You see the muscles are segmented, the vertebral column is segmented. It might as well, it could be human here. So we are segmented animals. Pygidium is the last segment of these animals. So on this model, if you would, that model is not complete. They did not show you the clitellum and everything else. So on this model right here, this last segment right here is called pygidium. And you will see that in arthropods too. Arthropods, the last segment of the abdomen is called pygidium. You'll see that in some of them. Okay, when we get to arthropods, next exam material. Okay, so right here is the head, the head of the animal. This is clitellum. And then this is the pygidium externally. I'm showing it to you with naked eye. When you grab an earthworm, you can find clitellum. Closest end is the head of the animal. The farthest from clitellum is the pygidium, the end of the animal, if you will, which bears anus and so on and so forth. These two are not metameres. These two are not repeated segments. The pygidium and prostomium, they do not differ as a segment. New segments form from the pygidium. So new segments of the animal, the new segments are formed from this end, right here. Opposite of tapeworms. You remember tapeworms, you had scolex, and the new segments were formed from the neck area, germinative zone. You remember all of that? Opposite of tapeworms, okay? And then, so where is the oldest segment? Of course, toward the head of the animal, right? The oldest segment on this model could be a lab practical exam question. Where is the oldest segment? It would be up here. These are the oldest segments. The youngest segment would be here, okay? Opposite, again, opposite of tapeworms. Coelom comes from mesoderm, and these are schizocoelous animals. Secretory system is closed. They have a heart, true heart, and complete digestive system, and that means they have a mouth and anus. That's what it means. And then regeneration. These are the animals can be regenerated. Some of you, if you have not decided what you want to do with your worms, your experiment, maybe you can decide that. You cut the animal in half and see how fast it grows, what happens to the other half. You know which half has the head and which half has the tail, the pygidium. Maybe that's, and then of course you add some variables to it, right? Yeah, different type of food, different type of environment, and then see how they regenerate. These animals, based on your textbook and most authorities, they are the most defenseless animals on planet Earth. They do not have any system to defend themselves. Other animals, the jellyfish, more simpler animals, much, much, much simpler animals than earthworms, they have a system to defend themselves, right? You remember that? They can poison, they have the cnidocytes, the nematocysts inside of the cnidocytes. They have a system to defend themselves, not these guys. These guys, annelids, they're really defenseless. The most defenseless animals on planet Earth are, but they do regeneration. You've studied some animals like, what was it? Sea anemones, right? They can regenerate. If you planaria, you study them, they can regenerate. Peritoneum of adjacent segments meet to form the septa, and that's what the septum comes. Hopefully a picture comes up and I can share that information. Circular muscles outside and longitudinal muscles inside, and they move by means of peristalsis, right? Where else have you studied peristalsis here this semester? Your esophagus. And of course your small intestine, large intestine, but small and large intestine also go through they go through segmentation too. Right. Yes, Glenn.
In the esophagus for peristalsis, that's the circular muscles inside it, where and the longitudinal is outside.
Longitudinal outside, circular inside. Yes.
Why is it the opposite for annelids?
Annelids, the longitudinal outside, same thing. Circular muscle outside and longitudinal muscle inside, but they still undergo the same process. And I'll show you some pictures. We do have a cross-section of these animals. So, yeah, I don't have to go to the cross-section. So, the circular the circular muscles are right here, epidermis, and the circular animal, circular muscles are here, just like planaria, okay? So, circular muscles are right here, and these are longitudinal muscles. Yes, opposite of our esophagus, right, or small intestine.
Esophagus. The same way.
What? Well, you're looking at, okay, so you're looking at your small intestine, your, and these animals, what is outside, what is inside. Inside is the lumen. You can, you're making the right comparison, but you know, outside of our intestine is, you know, other organs, other, but this is the outside of the whole entire animal. Am I making some sense? You're making a right argument, but still the process is same. The process of the peristalsis is same. The two muscles contract, one contract, the other one relax. I will come up with it. I will come up with, give you the definition of peristalsis in a minute. Hang on. And then what happens, the longitudinal muscles contract, circular muscles relax. Circular muscles contract, longitudinal muscle relax. They call them antagonistically, but anyhow, right here. Okay, this is one of, and I will we'll come back to peristalsis. I'll give you the definition. The general, I ask you today's question lecture question. What are general characteristics of generally what all annelids have in common? This is it. This is pretty much it. Okay, first, they are segmented. Of course, they have clitellum. Some of them have clitellum. Some of them do not, like leeches. Some of them do not have clitellum. Okay, and then we'll go over classification. And this is pygidium. This is the mouth right here. But when you look at the animal internally, here they are, the septum. You see the septums? Septa is plural. Septum is singular. Here are the septum, and here's the intestine, runs throughout the animal, from mouth through anus. And then what happens, the digestive tract, the intestine, is continuous. It's not being separated. Am I making some sense, everybody? So the blood vessels are also continuous. But what you have in these animals that is repeated, you have the cetacea repeated. Then you have kidney, and you will see some pictures here in a minute. You have kidney in here, you have a nephridia in here, nephridia in here, nephridia in here. So there are some units that are repeated, okay? And then, and that's pretty much what, and of course, there's a coelom in here, coelom in here, coelom in here. This came from endoderm, this came from ectoderm, the tegument, and then of course the muscles came from mesoderm. And the space in here, you will see some pictures that explain it better, why you have, why these animals are eocoelomate animals. Okay, so here's a cross section, longitudinal muscles. This is the, I told you I'll come back to peristalsis. Here is the definition of peristalsis. Longitudinal muscles, contract body shortens, circular muscles, body elongates. And that's what happens there. Like an accordion. If you watch an earthworm, you see that they move like an accordion. Okay, they elongate and shorten. Here is a cross section. You do have slide of this. And then, of course, on the model, you do have it right here. You do have microscopic slide of this. Yep, lab practical question. Okay, so let's go over them quickly. The very outside, maybe I should show it. The very outside is epidermis. Then you have circular muscle, longitudinal muscle right here. You can see them on the slide very nicely. And then you have blood vessels. You see them on the slide. Then you have intestine right here. And the rest, septum, of course, on your slide. No, you do not see septum on the slide. On the slides that you're looking at them, you do not see septum, but on the models you do. On the models we have septum, septum, septum. You guys see that? Septum on the top, septum, 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 septum. Okay, these are all septum. And then of course on that model you can see septum as well. Cuticle, yes, you have a very thin layer of cuticle outside of epidermis. Ventral mesentery, yes, I will talk about that. Ventral blood vessels, intestine, parietal peritoneum, yes, that's a structure that surrounds the coelom. That's, you do have it on your slides, peritoneum, that's the name of the structure. At the end of the longitudinal muscles, you see a membrane that is surrounding the cilium. Then you have epidermis, circular muscle, longitudinal muscle, and so on and so forth, septum, everything else we talked about. Let's go to the class. Class polyketone. Poly means what, guys? Many. And keto means what?
Bristle.
Very good. Okay. Nerus venus is the name of the organism. Of course, that line should not be there. You all know that. Is that right? That line should not be there. There should be another line. Anyhow, common name for them, clam worms or sandworms. Clam worms, sandworms. And then auricula is the lugworm, another organism I'm giving you the name of it. And then largest class, mostly marine. When I say largest class, what do you guys think? Very good. Number of species. So these are some of the things you should know. In this phylum, which one of the following, in phylum Annelida, which class has most species? Right here. Class Polyketa. An earthworm does not belong to this class. Okay, you will see. We do have slide of this and organisms. We do have this in the lab. Nerus venus. We do not have auricular. Okay. Largest class, mostly marine, have well-differentiated head. You can distinguish the head. They have a structure called peripodia, which earthworms do not have. Earthworms do not have peripodia, Nicole, but they have a paired appendages. All segments have it, except the first and last one. And I'll show you some pictures. Peripodia is biramus. Bi, it means what, guys?
Two.
Biramus, it means its branches. Look like this. That's what biramus means, right here. And I'll show you some pictures and you will see it in a minute. Hang on. We do have slide of this. We do have slide of peripodia. Peripodium, singular. Peripodia, plural. Okay, it's biramus. And then they do not have clitellum. And but they have many setae. They have a lot more setae than earthworms. And many setae. They have no clitellum, but they have many, many setae. Pictures? No. They're dioecious. What those does that mean? Dioecious means what?
Separate sex.
Sexes are separate. You have a male and female, unlike earthworms. It would be a nice essay question. What are similarities and differences between the sandworm and earthworm? And that was one of them, I think, last week question. Not this question, but last one, Maria. Is that right? Maria. Live on the rocks, burrow into mud or sand, and tuberculous polyketes are sedentary, spend much of their time in their permanent burrows and other organisms. So I gave you three organisms from this class. And head or peristomium has eyes, tentacles, and sensory palps. And I'll show you a picture of that here in a minute. First segment is called peristomium, right? That's the first segment. And then they have pigments such as hemoglobin. Fertilization external and larva is called trochophore. And pictures, no? Gonads swell during some time of the year, and gametes go to coelom, gonoduct, metanephilia, or rupture throughout the body wall. Active at night, chitinous jaw and sensory tentacles. Each peripodia has two lobes. Something I would like you to emphasize on the peripodia, and dorsal notopodium and ventral neuropodium. And I'll show you some pictures and we'll talk about it on your slides. Make sure, on microscopic slides, make sure you can tell them apart. If you don't know, holler at me, we'll look at it together. Both used for creeping and swimming, and here they are. Okay. Are you ready? So this is the actual one. We do have it in the lab, on different bottles, in a glass containers and so on and so forth. So this is the head region, the head of the animal. Most of the specimens you will see, you will not see these head you know, the jaws and the pharynx and the palp and so on and so forth, because it inverts, it goes in, it takes them, when they are dying, to defend themselves, they take that portion inside. If you want to open up one and dissect it, you can. Okay, and but they have this. You probably will not see it. Unless somebody, some of them died, one of them that died, and they did not evert that whole entire apparatus inside of it. I hope I'm making some sense. Okay, so they have jaws. They are made up of chitin. We already talked about that. And then what else? Everted pharynx. That's the pharynx that I was talking about. Evert, it means they can retract it inside, like pharynx of planaria. You remember we talked about planaria? Okay, that's just like that, but planaria is more extended. This pharynx, this is just the, it's longer, this is a much shorter structure. Palp, sensory palp, you remember that? They sense the environment with these structures right here and right there. You have two on those sides. Tentacles, these are the tentacles. And then you have the eye spots, again, they detect the light intensity, they cannot form image on these guys. And then, what else? Tentacles again, and then right here are the parapodia. Now prostomium. So that segment right here, all of this is called the prostomium, and peristomium is this segment right here that surrounds the mouth. Okay, so peristomium is this one, and all of this is the prostomium, before the mouth. This is before the mouth. This is where surrounding the mouth. And the actual real first segment is this one. Okay, so that's these are some of the things we talked about. Okay, cross section, you do have slide of it. You have slide of cross section of nares vernus. So what do you have? Let's go over peripodium. You do have another separate slide of peripodium. Okay? You have another slide of peripodium. You have another slide. The top portion is called your notopodium, and the bottom portion is called neuropodium, the ventral dorsal. So the top portion is bigger, and it has a lot of capillary for respiration purposes. Okay, the bottom portion, it has, not much that much capillary, and it's used also for creeping. Both of them is used for creeping, swimming, so on and so forth. And if you look at it, you do have a slide that shows acicular, and attached to acicular are many setae. Acicular, many setae are attached to it. Okay, on your slides, make sure you see those. Then ventral cirrus, do not worry about that. I'm not worried. You see it on your slides, but I'm not worried about it. Then you have oblique muscles. You have longitudinal muscles, circular muscles, longitudinal muscles, circular muscles, longitudinal muscles. Do not worry about egg, intestine. Yes, you see it. You do have slide like this, which shows notopodium, as I talked about it. And the bottom part, this part, is neuropodium. You remember I talked about the peripodium is biramus? You remember that? This is it. This is biramus, right here. Okay, so one branch is that one used for respiration, creeping, swimming, which is called notopodium. The bottom branch right here, this one, it is used neuropodium for not much of respiration, is used for creeping. And here I wrote down the term biramus for you guys. This is biramus. Ventral vessels, yes, epidermis, circular muscle, longitudinal muscle, coelomic epithelium right here in the earthworm, we call it peritoneum, you remember that, intestine, and now dorsal blood vessels, eggs, do not worry about eggs, oblique muscles, you might see some oblique muscles, and that's nephridium, I'm not sure on your slides you will see that. We do not have a model of this, but we have a slide of this. And then we have the actual specimens of these, so you will see them. Any question about nares vernus? Second one. Class oligoketa. Oligo means what?
Small.
Oligo,
few.
Not small. No.
Few.
Few.
Yeah.
Oligo, it means few. They have few what? Very good. There are few bristles. There are few keta. Setae, if you would. I want to make it some sense. You call it bristle, I call it setae. Same thing. The textbook calls it setae. Okay? Lumbricus terrestris. Guess what is the name of what? Lumbricus terrestris. This is it. We have two models already in the lab. Lumbricus terrestris. Sounds like somebody's mistress, right? It would be. If someday I have a mistress, oh, my wife, I hope she doesn't watch these things. If I'm going to call her Lumbricus terrestris. Huh? Mistress. No? When I say, oh my God, I mean, how do you dare to say that stuff? The world is watching you. If they're crazy enough to watch this, I guess they're crazy enough to hear to my nonsense. Okay, the night crawlers or earthworms, same thing. Earthworms, most are terrestrial. Most of the species in this class, are terrestrial. Some freshwater, some parasitic, and some marine. Okay. So, but the earthworm you're dealing with in this class right now, they are your terrestrial ones, right? Am I making some sense? No head or true parapodia. They do not have parapodia. And anterior end has clitellum. I talked about that. If you grab an earthworm, you see the clitellum, you know, the head is that end. The shorter end, I hope. You know what I'm talking about. Setae with a few exceptions. Darwin's finding, what Darwin said, I already talked about that. Darwin said that these guys, the earthworms are good for soil. Aristotle's called them, they are intestine of the earth. That was the Aristotle. And then Darwin said they are good for soil, and Darwin's contemporaries said, Darwin gone crazy again. They're not good for soil, they hurt plants. And what nowadays, you know, by research, they know that the earthworms are actually good for soil, and they mix up soil, and they bring the organic matters up so plants can use them. And farmers now love them. So they're good for plants. Each segment has four pairs of chitinous setae, except the first and last segment. Okay, peristaltic movement. Okay, we talked about that. Already. Digestion, quickly, let's go over them. I'm not too concerned. Whatever is important, I will stop and emphasize on it. Whatever is not important, I'm going to just read through it. Is that okay? Nicole, is that okay? Brianna, is that okay? Okay, so they're scavengers by sucking action of pharynx. So the pharynx right here, so yes. Right here, they have a powerful pharynx. If you look at it, it has a lot of muscles, and they suck the dirt. They actually eat dirt, believe it or not. And then their intestine absorbs all of the nutrients and goodies, and the rest of the waste material comes out from the anus. So from the powerful pharynx here, they suck dirt, they take in dirt, and they are using it. Calciferous glands, yes, they do have, these are the structures in here, next to the heart. It's hard to see, maybe on the video, but right here is the heart, right here is the heart. They have four chambers, they call it aortic arches, but next to it, these are called calciferous glands. Since soil has a lot of calcium, what happens if these animals absorb that calcium, they die. So they have a structure called calciferous glands. It regulates the amount of calcium. Okay, so that's what the function of calciferous glands is. They regulates the calcium level. Mouth in the first true segment, peristomium, and anus in the last segment. Of course, we talked about that. Peristomium is not a segment, and it is the anterior. We already talked about these. I'm reading through them because we already talked about it. Not that it's not important. Teflosol. Okay, so the intestine has, if you look in here, and you see it on your slides, on your microscopic slides, you will see this. If you look at the intestine, this is the intestine, and if you look at the intestine, right here, there's a fold, one fold. right? That fold is called teflosol. I hope I'm making some sense. In our digestive tract, we are more complex animals. You saw, it would be a nice question, compare our digestive tract with the intestine of the earthworms. You saw the villus, the finger-like projection on top of villus. There was microvilli. Brandon, is that right? There were microvilli and so on and so forth. Yes? If you want some coffee, listen. I have some here. So that's the fold of the intestine to increase the surface area for absorbing more nutrient. Elizabeth, is that right? You guys are sitting farthest away from me. That's not good. Chorogogen, almost function like human liver. On the surface, if you look at this model right here, and on your slides too, this is the intestine on the very outer layer. And if you look at it in here, they are showing it by, I don't know, creamish color. On this model, they are showing it yellow. The yellow is chorogogen. And what it does, it's like human liver. It makes glycogen. It makes lipid. And when animal is cut in half, these guys are involved in regeneration. Okay, I hope I'm making some sense. Chorogen almost function like liver, and these fats and glycogen are, they make the fats and glycogen are made by chorogen. And then they go around wound and regenerate body. Okay, so that's one of the function of the chorogen. Secretory system, again, I do not have much to say about the secretory system. I'm just gonna read it off. Again, circulatory system, you should know, heart has four or five chambers. These are heart. During lab practical exam, if I point at these, heart or aortic arches, okay, and it's a closed circulatory system. That's all I have to say, so let me read through and move on. Dorsal runs on top of pharynx, anus, digestive system. Ventral runs the aortic arches, and it takes brain to the rest of the body. Blood has colorless amoeboid cells called corpuscles and hemoglobin. These colorless amoeboid cells, which are called corpuscles, what do you think are similar to our system?
White blood cells.
Our white blood cells, very good. Our white blood cells, it's part of our defense system. Same as these guys. They say, Amir, what kind of defense system are you talking about? Yeah, I'm making an analogy. We eat our digestive tract, is that right? Full of junk, isn't it? The coffee you eat, the food, the water is full of bacteria, right? They do not. If those bacteria get inside, outside of the digestive tract, get in here, you all know what I'm talking about? Houston, we got a problem. You watch Apollo 13? Huh? Jonathan, is that right? Houston, we got a problem. We got bacteria in unwanted area. Same as these guys. So they have a defense system. Bacteria and unwanted junk cannot get out of the digestive tract. You know, some does, the food and nutrients, but the bacteria cannot get out. So that's why they have an immune system too. And it's called corpuscles, okay? I emphasized on this. I stopped. Is that right? Jasmine, I stopped and I talked about it. Excretory system. Each somite has metanephridia except the first and the last one. Nephrostome is ciliated. Cilia brings waste from cilium to nephrostome and joint waste material to the outside. Aquatic oligochaetes release ammonia, and here they are. I hope you cannot see it, but this is the information I would like you to know. I'm not too worried about the top stuff, but this is the one you should know. In animal kingdom, most animals that are aquatic, most all animals that are aquatic, they release ammonia. Are we human aquatic? No. Do we release? I said release, not make. You know your liver makes ammonia, right? and it turns Brandon, liver turns ammonia into urea, right? So the aquatic animals, all of animal kingdom, most of them release ammonia. Terrestrial animals, on the other hand, I showed you the structure. It's a little bit, I should change the coloring of it. Sorry about that. But you can see it on the video. It might not be clear. Terrestrial animals release urea, right? The waste, excretory system, I'm talking about excretory system. The excretory system, they release urea. And then the structure of Denise, is that right? The structure of urea and ammonia are right here. I showed it to you guys. I might ask, I don't know. Nervous system. Brain has neurosecretory cells. They secrete, they are endocrine in function and secrete neurohormones. Function in regulation of reproduction and regeneration, of course. Axon are myelinated, no eyes, but have many photoreceptors on epidermis. Most defenseless organisms on planet Earth, already talked about that. Jonathan, yes. Brandon, yes. No specialized sense organs. They do not have specialized sense organs like some of the mollusks, which we are going to discuss. Reproductive system, quickly, they're monoecious, the earthworm. I'm talking about primarily earthworm, but practice cross-fertilization. You already know that. We talked about it in case of your flatworms. The flatworms that they were not schistosoma was dioecious, but the flatworms like planaria, that they are monoecious, right? They do practice cross-fertilization. They do practice cross-fertilization, okay? And you all know what I mean by that, I hope. Okay, so what happens, female stores sperm from male in two seminal receptacles. They receive, easy to remember. So on the models, if you would, the purple right here, I don't know if you can see it or not, the purple, small purple in here, not inside, the in here, the small purples are seminal receptacles, the smaller. And seminal vesicles are the bigger purple ones. They are making, they make sperm and egg. So ovaries and testes are located. Same as this one. You guys see the two small ones, the two small white ones? These are seminal receptacles. They receive sperm and store it from another earthworm. But the big one right here, the big ones are seminal vesicles. Okay, that's another thing I'm hoping. And then we have specimens there that has been dissected for you. We have the earthworm in the lab. You can dissect it. And we also have a roundworm in the lab. You can dissect it if you wish. So reproduction happens during any season. They are not like nares verus. Clitellum secretes mucus that hold the worms together. And I'll show you some pictures. After copulation, a cocoon is formed around the clitellum. So they make cocoon, if you would. Fertilization of egg takes place in cocoon, and young adult that emerges from the eggs, and direct development, no metamorphosis. Juveniles do not develop clitellum until they are adult. So, and right here, I already talked about this a little bit for you guys, so I'm not going to go over it. You have the nephridia. Some of the slides you can see the nephridia. Here's the tiflosol intestine. This is coelom right here. Longitudinal muscle, circular muscle, epidermis, setae. How many pairs do they have? Four. They have four pairs of setae, pairs, or eight setae. Okay, and that's what the models indicate. Here's a clitellum, prostomium, setae, anus, pygidium toward the end. We already talked about this. Oh, seminal receptacles, they receive sperm, smaller one. Seminal vesicles, they make sperm. And here's a crop gizzard, crop for grinding food, crop for storing food, and gizzard for grinding food. G, gizzard, grind. Y'all know what I'm talking about, easy to remember. And crop for storing food. powerful pharynx. Here are the aortic arches. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 4 or 5 aortic arches or heart right here. Okay. And then we have septum. I feel like I talked about most of these. Oh, here is a peritoneum right here. It goes around, all around the animal. Okay, and this is the coelom, and this is the Kurgerji cells right here, Kurgerjian. And then the epithelial cells are inside. This is the lumen of the intestine. This is the tiftosol. I hope I'm making some sense. Look at them. You do have the slides. All of those parts are in your microscopic slides. Here is showing you the structure of setae, and the muscles are attached to setae. But again, as you mentioned, some of you mentioned this morning, the setae in the earthworm is vestigial. It really does not help as far as the movement of the animal goes. They're very small. They possibly had a function long time ago, but they evolved, and now they do not have a function anymore. Here is showing you the copulation and formation of the clitellum, the cocoon, and the cocoon moves toward the posterior end of the animal, comes off of the posterior end, the head of the animal, and right here, more than one worm in cocoon. So you have more than one worm inside of a cocoon. You have that, that is the fate of the cocoons, and you can see them here. The real one is a drawing. Last class, class Hirudinia, the leeches. All of the leeches are in this class. And Hirudinia medicinalis is the one that we emphasize, we work on. So mainly freshwater leech. So leeches, what I'm trying to say there, they are usually found in fresh water. We have a few marine leeches. We do. Okay. And then there are any color from black, brown, red, olive, green. They could be any color. They force their pharynx or proboscis into the soft tissue. And of course, they have powerful jaw-like chitinous, and they cut the skin, and of course, they suck blood. Temporary or permanent parasites. They're ectoparasites, if you would. Have you seen the movie Rambo? You guys are too young to see the first one. He goes in the water, tries to hide from enemy, and then when he comes out of water, his body is full of leech. And then he grabs his big old knife, this big, and then remove the leeches from his body. And it's all, my wife, when she first arrived to the United States, she was watching those movies. Amir, is that true? I said, no, it only happens in Hollywood. Anyhow. It could happen, I don't know. But in Hollywood, they like to dramatize things a little bit. If they would not, we would not go see movies. If they would imagine a small leech, just like the video you saw, would attach the feet of Rambo, you would not go see the movie. What kind of movie is that? You want big leeches attached all over the body, and he comes out of the water and grabs his big old knife. Have you guys seen the movie? No, go ahead and see it. You've seen it? Rambo? No? You've seen parts?
I don't know if it was the first one that I've seen.
First one. Rambo. Yeah, Rambo, the first one. Was it first one or second one? Yeah. No, first, second one. Sorry, it was the second one. The second one, he goes to Vietnam. But the first one, he's in the United States, and he does destruction. Is that right? We call it destruction. Anyway. No, I don't watch any movies anymore. I know. Very rarely, random. No appendages and setae. And anterior and posterior suckers got stores large amount of food. One semester we bought a leech, a live one, in a container, and that leech was alive for almost 2 years because the amount of food they suck, they can go without food for some of them. The one that I had in the lab, it was alive for 2 years or so, and I was surprised. No oxygen, it was tight jar. I don't know how he survived, but he did survive. After a few years, then he died. We didn't do anything. Here are the largest leech. This gentleman, he first discovered it. Anyhow, and fixed number of setae, 34 distinct coelomic compartments. Coelom is found around gonads. Okay, unlike The rest of that is important. I would like you to know, because this is something we refer to it later on. In these animals, both nereus and earthworm, you can find coelom from all the way from mouth to the anus, right? Each segment has coelom, right? But not in leeches. Leeches, you find coelom around gonads, testes, ovary. You find around the heart, just like us human. So you find them around gonads and other parts of the body. Septa disappeared, except in one species. Lacuna is a coelom which is filled with connective tissue. But they are not acoelomate animals. You remember, this is what you learned in acoelomate animals, but since they have coelom around gonads or heart or kidney, then they are coelomate animals. They feed on almost all species from insect to human. So every species have their own leech. Other leeches from other species can hang on to human. You know, they do some cross-feeding as well. Monoecious but practice cross-fertilization. No larval stages, gas exchange through the skin, aquatic ones as in the gills. The world's largest leech. Here they are. As you learn, we talked about it. If a toe or a finger or something has severed, has been cut, what the surgeons can do, they can put back the finger or toe together. But since there is a large amount of blood around the blood vessels, what happens, they put a sterile leech. Do not practice it at home. Don't go to the river in here and grab a leech and put it on your wound, because they carry bacteria, they carry parasites, they can infect you. It's a no-no. But these leeches that they grow in hospitals, they are very much sterile. They do not have any bacteria or parasites. Okay, so they put it on top of, after surgery, after the surgeon put the finger back or put the ear back or the toe back, whatever, after they've done the surgery, they did all of the sewing, so they put a leech on top. They come twice a day for 1 hour or so. It's not there all day, all night. So they put it in here and they suck blood and they remove it and then they bring it again. So that will take care of some of the hemorrhage, the pressure that the blood is putting on the blood vessels. So that way the blood vessels heal faster. They reconnect faster and easier. It's shown that is productive. Here they are in the ear. And of course, now the way that heals, it leaves less marking if you use a leech. So that is the ear. That's a finger that has been cut. And the surgeons put it back, and then of course this is the afterword. I got some of it. Coelom and metamerism may have evolved independently. It's not mollusks, annelids, and arthropods have many similarities that they may have a common ancestor. Okay, I'd like to start with mollusks a little bit.